Hi, I'm Van, the founder of CoHome. And this is our panel on the agents of co-living. So I think it isn't unfair to say, and I don't know if anyone's going to leap and punch me now, it isn't unfair to say that traditionally managing agents don't always have the best reputation. When it comes to customer service, when considering the tenant as the customer and not the property investor. So with that, co-living and agents can sometimes sound like oil and water. Over the last year, I've spoke to a huge amount of landlords, operators, agents, and whilst co-living approaches aren't uncommon among the operators, I was surprised to see that despite the perception that they're actually, despite that perception, there are actually quite a few agents that do recognize the co-living approaches and recognize that the house is also a home. And this recognition is good because there's very few businesses outside of property that can actually succeed without recognizing the importance of customer service. Co-living is often wrongly associated with being high quality design, something that an agent generally has little to no control over. They have operated the property that they're given. But for those that were in the sessions earlier, especially the co-living accreditation one, they'll know that 80% of co-living is service-based, with only the 20% being the property itself. With the strong business argument to co-living that we heard in, such as the one with co-living operators, it could be fair to think that agents of the future will become the experts in offering that level of service. So to discuss this, I've brought together representatives of three great agencies around the country who recognize the importance of service. So could you each please introduce yourself and say a bit about who you are? So if we start with Carey.
Hello, I'm Carey. I run a HMO or company that specializes in HMO property management called Emerald May Lettings. Been doing it on a self-employed basis now for about 8 years, so I've pretty much experienced everything you could imagine. And yeah, I really love the co-living element of HMOs. Is something I really kind of strive for if everyone else is willing. So yeah, that's me.
Okay, and Neil?
So I run a company called the HMO Guys. We cover Greater Manchester, Bury and Warrington for HMO management and lettings. And we also do some turnkey investment solutions. I launched the HMO Guys 2 years ago last month after working for another agent that did HMO management. And I thought we can do this better because all the agents that I met were very systems focused. And although I appreciate systems are very important as a backbone, we're in a people business. And my background before this was recruitment. Which was matching people into positions and people with people. So I wanted to bring the people side of it into HMOs. And that's where co-living came from and our name. We launched 2 years ago with one house and nine rooms in Prestwich in Manchester. At the moment, we manage 230 rooms across Greater Manchester.
Awesome. And Lee?
Hi, yes, I'm Lee from UrbanHome. Our key brand is Urban Share. And I've been in this since 2009. I became a HMO landlord myself, or house share landlord myself, in 2009. And I grew a management business by accident because I just didn't feel happy handing over my HMOs to the high street, where I felt they were gonna get lost in the swathe of other single lets that they manage and go into their cookie cutter slick for single let management strategies. So I set about networking and building a business, and we've helped many landlords in many situations, but we've certainly taken a lot from purchase. We've project managed the renovations, best use of space schemes, right the way through to ongoing management. And we've been working with the same landlords. We've got some landlords now that we've been working with since 2011, so I'm very, very proud of that. Live it and breathe it, really.
Brilliant. So Neil touched on something really early about being in a people business, matching people. One of the main pillars of co-living is the tenant compatibility. And that doesn't necessarily mean everyone has to be the same, but a mindfulness, just a mindful approach to compatibility. Often even well-meaning agents say they just don't have the time to know who's who and whether someone will be a good fit in the property. How do you try to get compatibility, and why do you think it's important enough to make that time? So if we start with Neil, who brought it up first.
Okay, I love my lesson about bringing things up first in the future. So the way that we do it, I'll be honest, so because my background came from 15 years in the recruitment industry beforehand, our process is based almost on like an interview strategy, because when I was in recruitment, my company at that point, we said that matching the dynamics of the people created a long-lasting relationship in a business. So ultimately, creating a similar dynamic in a household does exactly the same thing. So I suppose when we're looking at tenants, what we quite often do is work from an approach of tenant to property rather than property to tenant. So say we were to meet you to look at a HMO, we might meet you at one of our properties and sort of talk to you about what your sort of career aims are, look at how old you are, look at your interests and things like that. And then what generally happens, if I'm honest, is you look at that first house with us and then we go, actually, I don't think this house is the right house for you. I mean, hopefully it is. And hopefully we've got the first part of the screening right. But secondly, what we'll do is look at it and go, actually, I think that this house down the road is good, because do you know what? If we look at this number six on this street, this has got three engineers in and you're an electrical engineer. So that's some initial common ground to start from. And if we can find some common ground with the other tenants in the house, you're going to have a longer and happier relationship with your housemates and hopefully settle better in that house.
That's awesome, Carey. I know you do quite a lot of thought into that.
Yeah, I feel like you've I think we work very similar, actually, Neil. I'm much the same. Times quite often I'll meet somebody and I'll think, actually, yeah, no, you'd be much better off in this house, or I'll think of a load of people that have got similar interests and maybe recommend them to go somewhere else. It's just sticking them in the first room is definitely not, it's finding, you know, people that they'll blend with. Got similar values, you know, that kind of thing. That's way more important than just putting a bum on a seat.
I agree, yeah. And I think that you've got not just matching the people, but look at age groups as well. Because one of the things that we often find is that when we've taken houses over from some other agents in Manchester, is that we've got people that are 17, 18, or 18, 19, 20, and people that are 50, 55, 60 in the house, and there's just no relationship between them. They're just passing people, and that's not a home, that's a place to live.
Yeah, unless of course you're young at heart and you'd prefer to mix, but then you get that vibe from the person when you meet them.
Exactly.
I think it's always about the individual, and I think the key thing is not to assume anything, because I've definitely had viewings, and my team have done viewings where we've thought, oh great, you're a teacher and we've got another teacher in this property, and then you kind of say, well actually there's another teacher that lives in this, oh that's the worst, last thing I want to talk about when I'm not teaching is teaching. So actually, you know, the flip side of that is it's just about asking good questions and really understanding that, you know, that those if they buy into you and warm to you, that those good questions are actually going to get them the best possible outcome.
Yeah.
The flip side of that is of course that a cohesive house is going to stay longer. So it's an absolute win-win for the tenant, a win-win for us as the managing agents and the landlord as well.
Yeah. I don't think it's necessarily down to the profession, is it? I think it's down to what kind of person they are, if they're chilled or if they like to have a quiet house or if they've got more of a social side to them. And you kind of get the feeling, don't you, when you're chatting to them and you meet asking them what they're into, what they do. So it's like connecting people that got the same kind of values and interests more so than, you know, what career path they might be, yes, be taking.
Yes. And I think also it becomes an easier experience for the person viewing with you. So, I mean, I cast my mind back to the summer, COVID viewing in the summer when we relaxed a little bit. And we walked into a property, the sun was shining on the garden, the doors were wide open. The tenants had actually clubbed together and bought themselves one of these inflatable hot tubs. which they had to get on the go. They had a barbecue on the go. They were playing poker and drinking gin. And, you know, that person that came in just fell in love with that environment. But actually, I could have brought in someone that was quite introverted, who was living in a house share more because of cost. And that might not have worked for that individual. So again, I've learned never to second guess the outcome.
I hope you bought them all a bottle to say thanks for
telling the room. I mean, it was very inviting, I have to say. Yes.
Yeah.
And do you ever face any backlash from one of your customer, the property owner customers, who are saying just chuck someone in? And if so, how do you address that? Do you just have to go with it, or do you try and explain?
I think for us, it would be, sorry to jump in, if that's one of our customers that are doing that, they're basically saying fill our rooms and fill them with anybody that comes along, that's not a customer that we would generally work with, if I'm honest, because we've built the business based upon the values of co-living and landed, I suppose, a business like this because of that. And I suppose we've been very lucky in the fact that our customers are really understanding of that. The fact that, you know, it might take a week or two longer to fill a room, but actually if you've got a house of 12 happy tenants, that's much better than 12 full rooms that are going to turn over every 6 months.
Yeah, and I think it's always a fine line, actually, because the landlord has spent a lot of money developing a great home for individuals. They want the right type of tenants, but I can think of one landlord on my books at the moment that just really isn't in a position to suffer longer voids. And in London right now, you know, there are some voids. Being honest, that's the London market is a tricky environment at the moment. So it's that fine line between balancing the finances for a landlord and finding the right person. Sometimes we have to tread it a little bit closer than we'd like, but we've always got it in mind that the right environment, the right atmosphere is what we're after.
So two of the other five core aspects of co-living are customer care and integration. As I have said, some more traditional agents maybe have a worse reputation when it comes to customer care from a tenant perspective. Why do you think it's important, and do you have any examples of this in action? And I think initially I'd like to direct this to Carey, because I remember seeing some things on your social media that caused some...
You have to remind me what you saw now.
I think it was related to helping out people when they were isolating.
Oh, right, yeah. I think for me, it's just about being a human, really. So it's not about going over and above, because firstly, that should just be a normal reaction, is to want to help somebody. But yes, sorry, I lost my train of thought then. Remind me what you were asking me again.
Just I'm asking about customer care and integration. So what do you, first of all, why do you care about, you know, the customer experience? And are there any sort of practical examples that you do to try and give a good experience, or to try to integrate somebody into a property?
Yeah. I think it helps. I actually lived in a house share for about 4 odd years. So I know what people like and what they don't, and what gets on people's nerves. My bugbear is bad customer service. If I get bad customer service, I get proper grumpy. So for me, like, giving good customer service should just be like I said, just a standard thing. But also I love, like, a lot of my tenants, I get a lot of referrals and things, and I wouldn't get those, you know, if they didn't get that level of service. I get tenants say that they don't want to lose me as a landlord. They might want to move, but they want to move somewhere else because they want to continue the relationship with me. It's not necessarily the house. So I think, it's really important to build up that customer service, and it builds trust and good relationships. You can communicate better. There's like so many pros to it that, I think it's harder work to not give customer service. It just makes your life harder. So it's just a natural thing for me.
Lee, have you got any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I think... for me, it really, it depends what sort of, you know, there's various forms of customer service. There's the way we maintain the properties, and meet the expectations of our housemates and the way that we do that and the way that we communicate that. As an agent, we've got lots of communication going on. We're communicating with the tenants themselves, we're communicating with the landlord, with the contractors, and me and my team need to communicate effectively as well. So I think the whole thing about always making people feel welcome, be approachable. It's the little touches, it's the little things that you can do that often go the furthest. Sometimes just dropping off a couple of bottles of wine in the summer after a viewing to say, have a drink with your new housemate when they arrive tomorrow. Or it's the small things you do that go a long way. And we have a policy of keeping in touch on a weekly basis, even if it's just to share something that could be useful to them. We definitely put a lot of emphasis into that, and we get good feedback on the way we communicate, even just our visits to the property, because it's not always convenient for us to be turning up the houses, especially during COVID when people are working from home. So we definitely do our best. We don't get it right every time, but we strive to.
And Neil, I first heard about HMO Guys because someone was using you as an example of like a really good agent in your area. So
nice.
Talk a bit about your approach to this.
So I think that our approach comes from my background when we talked about recruiting, and I don't want to keep going back to this because I feel like a stuck record, but the way that we always view it is that although the landlord pays the bill, or the landlord signs, we would say that actually the tenant pays our bill, but the landlord signs the check. So what we've got to do is we've got to put the tenant first in the majority of scenarios. We've got to try and work to satisfy the landlord's requirements through the tenant and through the property, rather than looking at them all as separate entities. Because actually, if the tenant is happy and staying and paying, then do you know what? We get paid, we're happy, the landlord gets paid, they're happy. And it's a balance between looking after the tenant's interest and the landlord's interest and trying to reach a happy medium. One of the things that we change quite a lot is the periodics of inspections that we do. One of the agents we took over a house from used to do an inspection on all of the rooms every single month. And we just looked at it and went, actually, if that was my home, would we like that? Would I like somebody coming and inspecting me every month? Or what do? Do we employ a cleaner who is employed by us rather than a contractor? And then they go to the property and they report back to us every week on what they see and is there a concern? And if there's a concern, then we maybe step in a little bit more and do it. But what can we do to make things happen seamlessly in the background so that people are comfortable and it is a home rather than just a business? Because for the tenants, it's a home. For the landlord, it's a business. And for us, it's our job to mediate in the middle.
Yeah, that's really, really well said. So, I mean, despite best efforts, there can still be issues with tenants. Something which, if you're managing your own property, that can feel very personal and upsetting. But as someone who sits in the middle, how are you able to deal with this?
Do you want me to jump in on
that?
So,
I guess I should be disappointed, but no.
I mean, look, we've definitely dealt with most things over the years. If you get the vetting process right at the start, and we feel like we've got the right tenant in the property, then we've definitely set ourselves up to win. But as you say, occasionally there's a clash of personalities, or somebody, maybe it's experience. We've had it, in the last 12 months with somebody, having some issues around mental health as a result of COVID, and then that rubbing off on the other housemates, and them really doing their best to try and support this tenant, and then suddenly waving the white flag and saying, guys, you're going to have to get involved here. So it can manifest itself in lots of ways. I think sometimes when the tenant has an issue with the property, it can feel quite personal to the landlord, because the property is their baby. They've put their heart and soul into it. They've invested a lot of money in it, and they came up with what they felt was a really good product. So when a tenant maybe isn't treating it with respect or living in it to the standard that they would live in it, it can often be quite difficult. So that's when we try and remove the emotion from that situation and look at actually the bare bolts of things. Is the way this tenant behaving having a negative effect on the property or their housemates? If yes, how can we take action? if it's just no, but the landlords, you know, come to have a look and they're not happy because there's a something out that shouldn't be out, well, that's really us to manage and protect the tenants from that hostile and, dare I say, often trivial small matter. The other thing is, if we've already got the relationship there with the tenant, then we should be approachable and we should be able to work through things. And I'm quite proud of the fact that we've managed to never have to go to court to evict a tenant in the sort of 11 years I've been doing this. And I think that just comes down to just being a decent human being emotionally intelligent and just working through the issues with that housemate, offering support, offering flexibility, and doing all we can to help in that situation. But there are times when you have to be a bit firmer about things, and it's just knowing when you need to do that.
Yeah, I'd agree. And I think that one situation we've had that's been quite similar, actually, Lee, is we've got a house that we did most refurb on with the landlord, but the landlord is quite good friends with the next door neighbour. But doesn't really know us. We tried to get to know him, but he doesn't think we're important because we're the agent, I suppose. And every week he's sending the landlord a picture of the wheelie bins full, the cigarette ends at the back door. And the landlord is, like you just said, quite personally involved in it because it's his house and it's his first HMO and he spent lots of time on it. And it is just working to try and remove that emotion from the situation, because he gets really upset that the cigarette ends on the pavement at the back, when really, actually, do you know what, on Thursday the cleaner's going to sweep it up and it's all going to be all right, or the bin's full and the cleaner's going to take it out on Thursday and it's all going to be fine. But he's got a picture off the next door neighbour, and it is that difficult situation where there's nothing really wrong and actually the house has been looked after really well inside, but the personal involvement can be very difficult.
I can relate to that. I've got a few landlords like that.
Yeah, and I mean, we've got a landlady who, you know, has got a beautiful four-story property, dugout basement conversion, kitchen basement conversion, but it was her family home, and she's moved out of it to benefit from the income on it and downsized herself. So when she returns to the house that her children grew up in, you know, it's an emotional thing. And when she walks in, and the pots and pans are on the side still, and dare I say it, there's a drying rack that's not been folded away and things, that really grates on her. And so we're the ones that are kind of shielding the tenants and saying, don't worry, you know, we've got this. We're only here a few days ago. And we're having to sort of take the heat out of that situation, because dare I say, if she was communicating some of those more minor things directly to the tenants, it just wouldn't be well received, I don't think.
And it would essentially make them unhappy, wouldn't it? It would create turnover for you.
It would.
We in our house, we did a house swap, and I think when it's your own house, it can just feel so much more personal. You get back and you're like, I wouldn't have chose to have had those door frames scratched. But I think it's quite important for people to recognize, you know, when it's a business, recognize it as a business side. So the next question I've got is that so good service has a cost in terms of time, and that's probably why some people don't always put that to the front of their agenda. But the more forward-thinking agents can offset this cost with good processes. So what processes and technology do you have in place to try and make yourselves work as efficient as possible? And I guess the subtext here is that I think prop tech in general, agencies are generally slower to adopt things. But I know, Neil, in our conversation, I'm someone who's fairly techie, but you seem to be running rings around me.
So I'm one of these weird people that I don't like technology, but I'm quite good at it. So I can make things, I can build a website and I can build some a system that does it. But it's really hard for me to do because I'm not that interested. So we do lots of our stuff through Arthur. So I'm swearing in the room, I suppose, for you, Van, because I suppose it's not Coho.
No.
And then we I developed most of my stuff that we do is through a system called Podio, which is like a workflow system. So we've got workflows to do all of the mundane tasks. So if somebody's, you know, if we've got a viewing at a property, we put it onto Arthur, and Arthur emails all the tenants in there, text them beforehand to say we're coming and things like that. And we've got workflows if someone's moving out, of how to do a move out, how to do a move in and everything like that. So everything admin as far as we can is on a workflow. And what we've tried to do is remove anything that's admin biased from people in the team so that the team can be as small as possible, but so we can spend as much money as we can on having a team of people to do stuff, but not bog them down with, I suppose, day-to-day mundane stuff that, that isn't customer facing, because the people in the business are there for the customers, really.
So I'm still trying to figure out how to kick you from the thing. Lee?
I completely agree. The way we split our business is that, of course, if anybody calls in, we're all there to support and help. But each tenant has a designated person that they feel they've known from the start that they can deal with. And then, I mean, we, like Neil says, we have workflows. And really, the journey starts with that, with when we start the first viewing, or when we start the marketing for the first viewing, and we've got that interaction going on through one of the portals. And the move-in process is obviously keeping people happy, dealing with maintenance, tenancy renewals, whatever it may be. And then there's a whole process around moving out, because I think sometimes it's very easy to get the first two bits right and forget about the last one. And actually, they're our biggest advert. They've been with us for 2 years, 3 years, and they need to know that when they leave, they're going to get the same courtesies, same professional service, deposit back swiftly and effectively, and you know, hopefully, you know, a review at the end of it that's a positive one for us. We use workflows. We push from Arthur of Swarm as well, Neil.
It's all right. We're both there.
I'm not here.
We use a client money system. That protects clients' money and notifies and makes people feel more comfortable engaging with us, because they get the auto receipts when we receive money and invoices and the likes. They get a really professional flow. There's a lot of software in this industry that solves problems that don't exist. And I've picked my way through a lot of it, but we use that package for protecting people's money. We use Arthur for our workflows, for our day-to-day management. And then we've got another software that we use for monitoring workflows. The other thing that we do that I know you've touched on already today in one of your other Zooms is we do use MadeSnappy. We do use virtual tours as a way of A, giving better service, and B, saving time, because sometimes you can't quite get everything you need to on that first phone call. And as Carey said earlier, you know, we might get to a property and find out they're better suited to another, but we haven't got access agreed on that property, and we've got that person with us there and then. So the virtual tours are a really useful way of pre-qualifying, so that if they like it on the virtual tour, there's a really strong chance they're going to like it when they, you know, when you get them into the property, as long as, of course, they, you know, they enjoy their housemates when they meet with them.
I use MadeSnappy as well, actually. I love those tours. They are really good.
Yeah.
I asked them to do a talk for this, which I did in the morning. We recorded one, because I think it should just be a standard in all properties, really.
Yeah.
And it's a very important time now to be using them. We should be giving people the option to view virtually at the moment anyway. So that should be option number one before a physical viewing, really. So.
Yeah.
You got any more thoughts on it, Karen?
I was just going to say that I'm enjoying using Coho.
Here we go.
So that's moved me out. I was one of those really annoying people that had like 15 spreadsheets for things before Coho. But I'm really excited about it, actually, because although I've got people that work for me, I tend to do all of the property side of it, all the management, the viewings, the check-ins, the check-outs. So it's really going to take a lot of pressure off. And it's going to help me kind of automate a lot of processes. So I'm really excited about that. I think that's going to save me a lot of time in the long run. So that's what I use. Plus MadeSnappy as well, which is wicked.
You do you still use Vaboo?
Yes, and I still use Vaboo. Yeah, I've got the reward scheme. Everyone gets to sign up to get their discounts on high street shops and things like that. So yeah, lots of little I love Vaboo, actually. I actually sign myself up to it so I can get the discounts as well. But yeah, it's good.
Just said, Carey has always been my favourite.
I'll sign you up later.
I think the other thing you touched on there, Carey, was automation. And I think that that's another really important thing. So, you know, we basically inform people before the viewing, and then we update them with more information just a couple of hours before the viewing.
Yeah.
And then after the viewing, we have time-based workflows to give people useful content before they meet us and after they meet us.
Yeah.
And I think that's a really, really important tool that we've put in place. And we've definitely seen a positive effect on our conversions as a result of doing that.
We do exactly the same, actually. And after the viewing, they get a follow-up, and before they get one to say, you're still coming, looking forward to meeting you. And once you confirm, they get information of how to sign up, et cetera, as well. So, like you, it's really helped our conversions, to be honest.
Yeah. And one thing we do as well is if we feel as if somebody's really on the fence, but they're struggling to commit to us, and maybe they're also on the fence with another property, we send out seven top things to ask your landlord before committing to renting with them. And that's really weighted in there. It's designed to make people stop and think, you know, is this other company or this other individual I'm dealing with able to offer the same service as these guys? And they've shared this useful information with me. They potentially might have stopped me from a less professional operator. So we do that sort of thing as well.
That's a really good idea. Yeah, because I think when you're a tenant, I know from my experience, I won't speak for everyone, but I had no idea. I struck like gold with the one that I moved in with. But I did view a few before, and I had this was back when the fees thing was crazy as well. So, you know, it's good 10, 12 years ago. It's very hard to know who's good and who's not good until you see someone who's good. It's when you see a good agent that you realize that actually the quality is there and the other ones were bad.
Yeah, 100%. And as I say, it's the small things. It just needs time to put these systems in place, and then they happen for you. And I know that's what your system does as well. You know, all that kind of stuff and the brief chats we've had.
So to a new HMO investor that's just bought a property and just done it up nicely and is now sitting there thinking, shall I self-manage it or shall I speak to one of these guys? Why should we go with the latter? Carey, your thoughts?
Wow. I suppose...
Yeah, I can answer that. But that's not my job.
But all of the reasons we've just said, do virtual tours, we've got the reward scheme, we've got a brilliant system in place to automate loads of things, you know, save you loads of time. Plus, you haven't got to have the headache of speaking to whingy, moany tenants. Sometimes, obviously, lots of tenants are lovely too.
Obviously.
But I suppose, to be honest, at the end of the day, a landlord has to want their property to be managed. I think if they've got it in their mind that they're going to self-manage, you're going to struggle to win them over. But sometimes those landlords will come back to you because they'll do it themselves for a bit and then realise it's not as fun as they thought it was going to be. Or, I don't know, that one particular landlord, he's actually realised that he's making more money running his business than he is running his properties. So he's decided, actually, I'm going to focus on what I'm making more money on, and I'll give you that to make me some more money.
Yeah.
So I think it really does depend. You'd have to ask the landlord at the question at the time. But I think if somebody's got it set in their mind, you're probably going to struggle to win them over, because a lot of landlords, it's all about the money, isn't it? How
I guess
much
they have
money
to
put in their pockets.
Yeah, they have to realise that their time is also money, and can they convert their time to something more?
Yeah.
Can they convert their time to more money by not managing it? Invested in property. Maybe they can.
If you've got a winning pitch, let me know.
I think maybe it's about talking to them about where their skills lie, to be honest. And you know, if they're an investor who's good at raising finance, good at finding deals, good at doing conversions, actually, have they got a spare 10 hours a week to manage tenants doing that? Have they got preferred supplier agreements with contractors who can go out to their properties 24 hours a day? You know, if at 10 o'clock on Saturday night the boiler breaks, do they know somebody who can go out and fix it, or are they going to have to put down the beer and get somebody to drive them there? You know, it is, have they got the systems in place to keep their tenants happy? Because losing one tenant and having a void of a month is probably more expensive than using an agent to manage that property.
I completely agree. I mean, for me, it's four things. I think you summarised that really well, but it's experience, compliance, power of negotiation, and time. And, you know, experience, you know, not arrogantly, but I can boast over 10 years of doing this, and purely because that means that over that time I have improved, I have learned a lot. I've seen the good and the bad and the ugly. I've had over 1,500 tenancies go through in that time. And so, you know, every eventuality that could have surfaced probably it has. And we've been able to fine tune, tweak, adjust our processes to tighten up. Compliance is changing all the time, as we know. And there's over 300 different pieces of compliance out there, regulated lettings industry at the moment. And keeping up to speed with that, keeping up to speed with the changes is sometimes quite a job in itself. And you may be able to rely on like the NLA to push updates, but it's not enough. You've got to be immersed in that world of compliance to grasp it and understand it and keep yourself safe. You know, I recently can talk about a rent repayment order. We took over management of an HMO where the tenants decided to go after the landlord for a rent repayment order. And, you know, it was a significant sum of money and it went to court and, you know, it unfortunately went in the tenant's favour and it was a significant amount of money. So, you know, things like that, you know, poor compliance and poor systems, you know, would have, you know, definitely contribute to that. With negotiations, I think it's all about actually being able to put the brakes on. You know, when it's the landlord and the tenant face to face, it's very easy for the tenant to lean on the landlord a little bit and say, oh, I don't suppose we could, or you'll do this for me, won't you, or whatever it might be. Whereas actually, it could be something that's perfectly fine, or it could be something that really doesn't need to be provided by the landlord and it is a bit of a tricky question. And we can definitely put the brakes on that. Sometimes in negotiating at the end of contracts, you know, they might need to leave earlier than their contracts allows and catch the landlord on the hop, and the landlord might agree to the wrong thing because they didn't want to lose face with the tenant. And we're in a position to say, actually, you know, you need to honour your contract. You know, you've signed for a contract, you know, we're here to support you, but ultimately we can't see a loss of income to the landlord during this fixed term. And then time. And I think a lot of landlords really enjoy at first the process of a smooth running new shiny HMO, but actually when the first issues arise that's when the wheels kind of fall off and the, you know, the potato gets a bit too hot to hold. And also I think they quite quickly realize that sometimes they have created another job for themselves, and actually it was fun for the first 12 months, but is that actually what they want to do? They've created more income and they've created another job. So it's but different horses for different courses, but we feel that those four areas are really, really where we support.
Yeah, I mean, I think from my perspective, how I see it is that co-living, I think, is going to start to be really good for agents, arguably, because at the moment, if you go with, let's say, a very traditional agent, they're doing a good amount of admin for you. Admin that as systems progress, you know, like what with what we're trying to build with Coho, we're trying to limit the admin as much as possible. But what something like Coho can't do is offer a really like specialized customer service. Like that is something that that takes time to learn and to perfect. Like just before this session, Leah Ziliak gave a talk on how to use hospitality best practices in co-living. And it is such an area of depth. It's the management of a property goes beyond just the regulatory stuff. And the regulatory stuff on its own is hugely important because, as you said, you know, the rent repayment orders, with the people who chase down the PPI things now starting to look at landlords and asking tenants to show them all the documentation they got to make sure it was all okay. That's scary, but that's just an aspect. The other aspect is this huge amount of added value you can add to a service with that, with the expertise that comes with understanding service.
And I think the other thing is that you know, everybody, when they start a co-living house, I think wants to do the best by their tenants, but sometimes they're just not geared up for it. You know, if you own one house share or two house shares, that doesn't give you the benefit, the flexibility of scale to have the team that can respond quickly, the team that can deal with the lockouts or the fire alarm at 1 a.m. as we had last Sunday morning at 1 a.m. You know, all of these things are important, and I think if you're an individual or a couple, you tend to want to spend your social time together. So it would, you know, always involve, you know, husband or wife going out to deal with these issues. And I think the flip side, and the really important flip side of that, is what happens when you take holidays. You know, if you're sunning yourself on a beach outside of COVID times, God, what does that feel like? If you're sunning yourself on a beach and you know, how can you respond to those situations that might arise? You know, we've seen landlords leaving a cheap pay-as-you-go type mobile phone with a friend that can answer it if a tenant calls, but that friend is then put in a very difficult position because they don't have the experience or the knowledge or the training to do the right thing and to make sure that that job's done correctly. And another thing that we do to really support our landlords is we really go to town on the compliance with our contractors. So they all sign SLAs with us. We've got all their insurances on file. They have to commit to operating and behaving a certain way in our properties so that we know that we're going to give the best possible service to our tenants. And I think it's often quite dangerous when there's a leak and your normal plumber can't attend to be going flicking through Checkatrade or My Builder or Facebook or whatever and just trying to find somebody that can attend, because you haven't got any terms of business with that individual. And ultimately, you're asking them to go into somebody else's home and provide a service. So yeah, I think the scale of an agency goes a long way as well.
Agreed, yeah, I agree completely with that.
We'll wrap up very soon, but I just wanted to ask another question that that came from a panel we had before. We had a panel that was talking about co-living over 50, an area that probably isn't, I think it's potentially emerging, but it's slow, but there's a lot of people that can see the opportunity for it. I just wondered if you guys had had any thoughts about that space. And you can just say no. I know I haven't pre-warned any of this.
I've got quite a few tenants that are over kind of 45, 50. They all seem to be quite kind of chilled out individuals, quite young at heart, that kind of, so whether, you know, there's a certain kind of percentage of people in that age bracket that just don't ever think that, you know, a co-living environment would be suitable for them, whereas the ones that like are more open-minded, you know, up for it. But I think it could be something that really takes off, because if you think about all the people, unfortunately, getting divorced, lots of separations due to the pandemic, you know, people wanting a change of scenery, deciding to move away somewhere new, you know, there's loads of different scenarios now whereby people might want to kind of keep their lifestyle affordable, you know, not have to rent out a whole entire house or a flat. I think it's something that could really take off if the right, you know, person came along.
I would agree, actually. I mean, we have moved a guy in today, 45 years of age, set of changing circumstances, but actually he's not. I think the difference with him is he doesn't see a house share as a backward step. He's quite happy to kind of open his eyes to a more inclusive living environment and not spend more money to live on his own in a studio flat.
Yeah, they want more social side of it, don't they?
Yeah, so I think that's really important. I think, and I definitely see a market for it, because is it ideal always having sort of 25 to 35-year-olds living with people in their late 40s, 50s. I think sometimes at that stage of life, people have got a slightly different outlook and mindset and goal. And so having a product that's, that was targeted at that market, I think has its place, and I can really see it working. We've got a tenant that's been with us for 8 years now, and he's in his early 40s, so he joined with us in his mid-30s. And I see that being more commonplace and more common practice.
I have to agree with you, Lee, that I think it's, there's a very distinct place for it, but it's quite a different product to the young professional market. So we've got, and I think you hit the nail on the head with that, the person moving in has to see it as not being a backward step. It's got to be a correct situation for them rather than a solution to a problem necessarily.
Yeah, financial bills.
Exactly. It's not just got to be the cheapest option. It's got to be the right option as well.
Yeah, no, I agree. And actually, I think often the right option is not to be moving in with 25, 30-year-old people. You do get 45-year-olds that are young at heart, and actually it works really well. But again, I think it goes back to what I said at the beginning of the class, never second guess what somebody wants.
Great.
You know, we've definitely got a couple of tenants who are saying, do you know what, I think I'm getting a bit wrong with this house now. And they have, their situation changed, their mindset changed. I do see that as being a really interesting product.
And I think it's, like you said, it's not second guessing it, but also not always taking it at face value, because you've got to